Good morning and welcome to our UU Colton Weekly Service online edition, coming to you from the Unitarian Parlor right here in Colton, Maine. As we resume our regular services after the holidays, we are continuing part 5 of our series on belonging, developing a sense of place and community. And today's topic is closing the gap, exploring variables that lead to change. We're going to look at a couple of case studies of individuals who registered a significant shift in their perspective and how belongingness played a factor. We're so glad that you are joining us no matter where you might be, online or right here, and we thank you for spending part of your day with us. For our prelude this morning, we're doing two Bobby Hutcherson tunes in a row. He started off last week on New Year's on one of his albums from the early 60s. And this is from 1966 of the album Happenings. And Bobby Hutcherson is the vibraphone player. Joining him on this is Herbie Hancock on piano, Bob Cranshaw on bass, Joe Chambers on drums, who also plays vibraphone and composed two of the songs on this album. And it's recorded at the Rudy Van Gelder Studio in Englewood Cliffs, New Jersey, February 8, 1966. And the title of this, again, it's a contemplative, the vibraphones have a penetrating, sustaining tone. In jazz, sometimes it can be moving rapidly. In this song, in Bouquet, it's a slow, sustained, leaving plenty of space. You can almost feel the cold air in between the notes. So this is our centering piece for this morning. Thank you. and alert to what is here in this space. Let us sit calmly, breathe, and listen to the sound of a chime.
Thank you.
all. We are one, yet separate, sharing this life together. Let us light candles this morning as we continue the journey. Lighting his first candle for getting through this cold winter. We've been fortunate with snow removal thus far, and oil prices have been not as pricey as feared. But again, everyone is pacing themselves to get through this winter with our fuel tank, wood pile. So this candle is for that moving forward into the winter.
This is a candle of joy. she got a job as of Wednesday working at Meyer, which is a box store in Indianapolis. And this is an opportunity for her to also overcome her anxiety with driving. She has to do stuff on her own. So, really thankful that she has a job.
Encircles us, encircle all. May those who endure hardship find relief. May those who suffer in body or mind experience healing. May we find ways to assist and benefit those in need, for in so doing, we benefit them, ourselves, and all. The universal is discovered in each heart. We are one. Amen. Across this reading today, number 498, as our newly elected Congress arrived in Washington this week, looking to give words of encouragement as both parties work together on the challenges that face our nation and our people. And this is by Howard Thurman, who was a Chief Justice of the U.S. Justice Supreme Court. And this is one of his prayers, and we're going to say it in unison this morning, number 498. In the quietness of this place,
surrounded by the all-pervading presence of the Holy, my heart whispers, keep fresh before me the moments of my eyes resolve, that in good times or in tempests, I may not forget fresh before me, the moments of my
life. So when we talk about trying to make change and shift, you know, a video like this, you know, reaching the children at this young age, I call this Sunday school theology. You know, we learned this when we were children in Sunday school, these basic truths of inclusion, you know, diversity, and it can be as simplified and basic as that from that age up. I'm not sure what happens along the way where we get diverted and lose that and complicate our theologies and divide our neighborhoods, and the children lose some of this basic entry information that is so formative. So, So that's what today's topic is on, is how do you see this kind of significant shift, and how unusual is it, and how does, what's the process or variables included that can help track that kind of change? So what I want to do is, for a reading this morning, this comes from Forbes magazine issue, February 2016, written by Josh Linkner, and it's titled, How to Explore New Opportunities. And on the bulletin, you'll see the symbol of Mind the Gap, which I hadn't seen until a couple of years ago. But Mind the Gap is a famous phrase. And this is what the Forbes magazine topic is on. If you ever travel to London, the iconic phrase, Mind the Gap, is one that you cannot miss. The automated warning is heard thousands of times each day at every stop on your subway system. The London Underground, affectionately known as the Tube, is the oldest rapid transit system in the world. In 1968, over 100 years after the system opened, a recorded voice was installed to warn travelers to watch out for the space between the platform and train, instructing people to mind the gap each time a train stops system-wide. This cautionary phrase since has become synonymous with London living and appears on t-shirts, as a punchline for jokes, video games, and throughout modern culture, and right on the cover of our bulletin this morning and the bulletin. The phrase can also be a powerful slogan in your personal and or professional life. It reminds us to explore what's missing, what's not there, or what could be. Recited with the same rhythmic consistency of the London Underground, it's a phrase that can open up new doors of opportunity in your mind. Minding the Gap works inside your organizational chart. Addressing internal soft spots helps you fortify your company against emerging competitive challenges. The earlier you mind the gaps, the less painful the remedy for your company, and the more productive the result, the oversights, the missed gaps. Relationships are another area in which minding the gap can help. Both personal and professional relationships tend to fall into predictable patterns, with blind spots that can grow geometrically into serious damage. Taking a pause to mind the gap and explore any missing area can help avoid plenty of pain from underperformance and unnecessary assumptions. Let this mantra lead you to fresh ideas, opportunity, and inspiration. Mind the gap. Queen's orders. It's been over a month since we've worked on this topic theme for the year on belonging. So I thought it might be helpful after the holidays and Advent and Thanksgiving to do a speed course review of where we're at now back in January. So I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, these are some high points just to kind of get us moving again in the right direction with some momentum. Maybe you'll remember some of these things. Maybe you won't. If you weren't here, you've got a good excuse. But see if this if you remember any of this at all. Belonging or belongingness is something known as situation crafting, as Cohen uses the term in his book Belonging. Creating or shaping a situation, even in seemingly small ways, in order to promote or create a sense of belonging. And organizations do this, school systems do this, churches do this as well. And you may remember we had a diagram early on called the Wheel of Belonging. You know, it had 10 different tabs on this wheel, and you could actually take a quiz. I forget the details, you have to go online and see how to score the test. But the categories were 10 qualities or felt expressions of belonging that you may or may not have felt here or other places that you're a member of. And the 10 qualities on that chart diagram were to feel invited, feel welcomed, to feel known, accepted, to be involved, to feel supported, to be listened to feel like you've been heard, befriended, needed, and present. Situation crafting has multiple aims. One, creating a stable setting where a sense of belonging is established. In churches, we call that sanctuary, safe, stable place. And secondly, creating a new setting that is inductive to change and transformation. Situation crafting is the science and art of creating a space and setting, space and setting for a sense of belonging and transformation are the two primary things going on with this intentional situation creating. And Cohen shares his triple T's of situational crafting, which were tailoring, targeting, and timing. The right psychological message, is the tailoring, occurs for just the right person, targeting, at just the right time, which is the timeliness, where everyone's on their own time schedule on the subway. Everyone's got a different destination and timing. You may get held up at an airport unexpectedly, but the timing, you can't second guess what's going on for someone else because they're on their own time too. And timeliness is a key part of when change might occur or when a person is ready to join a community or feel like And we also looked briefly at two challenges so far when it comes to belongingness. We did a service on belonging uncertainty. And then the last service we did was on polarization. So, belonging uncertainty is a term that refers to a state of mind in which one suffers from doubts about whether one feels fully accepted in a particular environment. And it's something everyone experiences from time to time in some manner, to some degree. And every time it occurs, it's a healthy reminder to realize how fragile and delicate this nature is when a person feels like they belong, or if they feel set back or off to the side. So wise interventions and situational crafting can, ideally, it sets in motion a virtuous cycle of positive reinforcement. Any time a person feels a little uncertain, it's key in the timeliness that someone says something or does something. It can be very small, but it gives personal, direct reinforcement. All of a sudden, they feel like they've listened to, that they fit, that they belong, that they're valued. And just a small one of those occurrences makes a huge difference. It can reset a person who is feeling a little distant. It can bring them right back as feeling an important part of that group. Empathy and group awareness also assist in lowering belonging uncertainty. Even a brief and passing affirmation can have a significant and lasting effect. Not making assumptions and accessing empathy can assist us in sensing and seeing how someone else might be experiencing the same situation as us, but they are experiencing it in a different way. It's just that unique felt experience each of one of us are having, all in the same room, with the same content, the same happenings. And then going on to polarization, while it's important to feel like you belong to a group or a movement, it's also important that your relationship or point of view regarding other groups does not devolve into an us versus them dynamic. And we looked at Cohen's 9 tips to help minimize polarization, which is on page 314 in the book. And we also, it's on the UU support page, and we put that list of the 9 points out there. And in today's bulletin, you'll see I added my own, Dave's 5 tips when trying to close the gap on this polarization issue. We're not going to spend any time on those today. What we're going to do is take a brief look at 2 case studies that appear in this book of 2 individuals. And then move on to, I came up with 4 key variables in helping to close the gap or to create shift. So starting out, if you've read the book, you remember him talking about his roommate in college when he was at Cornell, his freshman year, I believe. And Cornell at that time, I'm not sure of a date, early 80s, he may have been at Cornell in college. And it was a relatively liberal educational environment at Cornell in those years. And his roommate, named Hank, was from Georgia. And they were roommates at Cornell. And he and Hank were like totally different backgrounds, experiences, political views, and they would have conversations in their room, primarily, and arguments that could be heard all the way down the hall. Hank and Jeff were famous for these arguments. Hank was on the debate team at high school, and would typically, even though Jeff would come up with what he felt strong arguments for his position on political, personal, and theological points of view, Hank would always hang in there and had well-prepared counter points to make. And neither one of them, even though Jeff was convinced he was right, Hank would always kind of come out on top with his debating skills, his preparation. And the saving grace with Hank was he was basically a kind and a good guy. And even if they had one of these loud debates and arguments, Hank would always make sure he'd find a way to help restore the relationship. They'd go out to Taco Bell for buy him tacos or do something to bring there, because they were roommates. They had to live together. And Hank, where Jeff said he typically was the one who would hold grudges and take it personally, would have a hard time with Hank, and Hank wouldn't change. They weren't changing their views, but Hank would always make sure they had some kind of connection. Well, the next year, Jeff went away to Europe on work study for foreign studies program. And while he was gone, Hank joined a fraternity on campus. He always felt there weren't many Southerners on campus in those early years, and Hank dressed differently, culturally, different background, and all of these dynamics, he was dramatically outnumbered on campus in all of those areas where identity is so key, especially when you're in college and trying to find your place. So Hank joined a fraternity saying that he was looking to find a community. So Hank joined a fraternity because he wanted to find a community of students he could feel at home with, which had been his challenge all along. So he found one and joined. And what happened early on was his views on homosexuality came up in a conversation. And one of the members from the fraternity walked out. Hank didn't realize that his brother was gay. Turned out half a fraternity was. And as it unfolded, as he talked to his brother to find out how he offended him, and to try to gain an understanding of who his brother was, how he had arrived where he was, and his points of view. Very difficult conversations, but they hung in there because Hank was committed to the group, where he felt affirmed by the group of these new brothers. And it was, was upset when he realized he offended someone that deeply in his group. And over time, quite quickly, his views changed, where Hank became a champion for free speech on campus, for groups that were meeting, and to become brothers connected to his fraternity. His views had changed not because of any argument, but because he had come to identify with a group whose members he cared about and that advocated and loved norms of tolerance, was part of the fraternity approach. He was affirmed by those in the group, which, as we'll see, is one of these points. That affirmation is one of the catalysts for opening someone's mind, and likewise their heart. And the second case study is from page 307. A real-world example of the power of values affirmation to de-escalate tensions between political adversaries and to help find some common ground comes from the 1978 Camp David Accords, as related by President Jimmy Carter in the book Conversations with Carter. Carter had arranged the summit in which he brought the Prime Minister of Israel, Menachem Begin, and the President of Egypt, Anwar Sadat, to Camp David in Maryland for a week of negotiations. The odds of a peace deal seemed remote. Egypt wanted Israel to return land and political prisoners, which Israel adamantly opposed. And Israel wanted Egypt to propose a permanent truce, about which Egypt was reluctant. Negotiations turned sour, and Prime Minister Begin packed his bags. But Carter caught Begin at the elevator before he left. Pulling out a folder, Carter removed 9 photographs of him, Begin, and Sadat together at the summit. He handed them to Begin, telling him they were intended as mementos for his 9 grandchildren. On back of each, Carter had inscribed the name of one of Begin's grandchildren. As Begin looked at the photographs and said nothing for a while, his eyes teared up. Then he read aloud the names of each grandchild and said, "There must be a way, there is a way, for our children, for our next generation." Begin returned to negotiations, and by week's end, he and Sadat shook hands over the historic Camp David Accords. Carter had reminded Begin of his deep commitment to the values of family and making the world better for our progeny. How might we as individuals provide affirmation to those from across the political divide to build better relations and perhaps even find common ground? For one thing, we can state our belief in shared values, such as family, the world, the next generation of children will inherit, and caring for friends and community. We can avoid implying that their views are based on either ignorance or bias, and ask people in a genuinely curious manner about what their views are and why they hold them, which helps people to feel seen and heard. And we can listen respectfully to their answers. Our attempts at perspective getting may surprise us. In many cases, we'll discover that we disagree not so much because we and our adversaries hold different values or have different views on the same issue, Rather, it's because the very issue as we perceive it is different. When liberals and conservatives fight about Social Security, or welfare, or abortion rights, they often fail to realize they are proceeding from different factual assumptions about what the social problem is and what the policies being considered actually are. By perspective getting, we can better identify the sources of our disagreements and work through them. I know that's a lot of content right there, but to unpack that, it requires very close listening to get at what the problem is. Starting out, the values may not be that different. And the issue, how it's set up, needs to be presented. And a guided conversation coming to the place of what might actually address or correct the problem identified. So what I'm going to give in the last few minutes here are these four variables of helping close the gap. And from these two case studies, I'm hoping you'll see how they fit in. Number one, mutual respect. Two, connection. Three, close listening. And four, suspended judgment. And each one of these will probably require conversation around that. I just want to put those out there today. The key is to start out the conversation, or the mutual respect leads to the connection. Human connection on a personal connection. And with the close listening, you reminded me of this fifth agreement that we have from the Don Miguel Ruiz book, which is be skeptical but learn to listen. And the idea of that fifth agreement is you don't have to agree. All you're really trying to do is gain information and to get a feeling for where someone is coming from, what their felt experience is. And that requires some very close listening and some patience. Putting all of those intricate personal pieces together so you can size up, well, what you do have in common. And you always maintain that your own integrity or that skeptical nature of you're not necessarily agreeing with someone. It's that process of connecting, respect, and getting as much information to understand the full issue, which may expose some of your own biases or blind spots that you may not have heard a full explanation. Or at least you get to see that empathy to find out what someone is feeling, how they are arranging the information to work with in this extended conversation to arrive at if there's a solution or something trying to be accomplished. And the fourth aspect of the suspended judgment really is that patience, trusting the process and the timing. Going back to Dave's five tips, don't try to do too much. Of course, gently, look for common ground. Ask plenty of questions. And don't get upset or lose that connection or lose the mutual respect in that process. When you feel like you're beginning to lose that center, it's a time to mind that gap. You know, pause, create just enough space for yourself if you need it. And oftentimes, to read the situation and to give them space. You're not trying to leave someone on a timetable. These are just very small bits and pieces and moments of drawing closer to a consensus. Not that the consensus really is as important as the connection to that individual and that process. It's probably more valuable than arriving at whatever point you're trying to make or point of view it's an interesting, this part of that gap in between is process and end point of working and both in motion and moving in a conversation. And this is a difficult practice to do one-on-one. What to do in a group makes it even more variables and factors come into a group conversation. And in this book, and in this process that we're going through this year on this topic of belonging, is exploration of self, our own emotions, our own points of progress that we're trying to make on our path of inclusion, widening our views, understanding more, and including more individuals and people here in this space, in our communities, in our family, our national discussions as well. It's an opening of the heart and an opening of a mind. So in closing, there's a quotation in the bulletin that I'd like to use in closing. This is by author Laurence Overmire. And Dale, if you have your reading glasses right there. And I apologize, it's a very small font. Yeah, that's the one.
What is really important is not what we believe to be true in our heads, but what we know to be true in our hearts, love. In other words, if a person is loving and kind, that ought to be enough to connect with one another and work together for the sake of all of our children. We need to care about all human beings, all life on the planet, and the planet itself. That's where we have to agree.
We extinguish the chalice for today, but the light does not go out. We carry it with us, the light of compassion, tolerance, and a new vision for a better world. Peace and loving ways to you all this week.
We want to thank everybody for tuning in today. If you'd like to show your support, please hit the like button, subscribe to our channel if you're not already subscribed, and help us out by sharing this message by clicking the share button. If you'd like to make a monetary donation to the UU Church Holton, there is a link to our online donations in the video description down below. And again, thank you so much and have a blessed day.